Okay, my name is Wanja Nyingi and I am a writer, editor at ISD, and I've just come out of coverage of the third meeting of the working group on the post-2020 Global Biodiversity Framework. The HR targets are too many people who are not as successful as they were intended to be, and the decade that they covered continue to have a lot of deterioration of biodiversity. And there's different polls and different discussions about whether it was because developing countries did not have the financial capacity and the human, scientific, and technological ability to implement the goals, or whether it may have been just a lack of willingness, political will, and cooperation. So there's been a lot of talk about where do we go from here. And throughout, there's been a lot of talk about we want to be ambitious. You know, we want to be transformative because we want to finally bend the curve on biodiversity loss. Over the years, even while the HE biodiversity targets were being implemented, scientists had continued to say there's going to be pandemics. If we continue to treat biodiversity as a second class issue, we're going to have a world of pandemics. We're going to have disasters and illnesses that are going to affect the whole world. And just as the GBF was being negotiated, COVID hit. So things became real now, and everybody now wanted to say, okay, now here we are. We are really at the prophesied moment of biodiversity-related Armageddon. During the meeting, one thing that came out because of COVID as well is that even though DSI, as it's called, has been used even for vaccines, the issues of access and benefit sharing are live. We're seeing them today. And nations were saying, look at how disproportionate it is that DSI is benefiting only developed countries. At the same time, we are talking about access and benefit sharing from this kind of information. How can we make sure that everybody is able to benefit for the purpose of all citizens of the world? So there's been a lot of divergence. Should we have agreements between nations? Should we have DSI follow access and benefit sharing protocols of the Convention on Biological Diversity? Or should we look at this in a different way? Indigenous peoples and local communities are saying now that, look, we are the custodians of biodiversity in our territories. So if you're going to use any of that, either for genetic purposes or for any other purpose, then we need to have benefits stream back to us. So that's going to be a big issue to be discussed on the way forward. The main part will be in Geneva in January. That is where now they will really negotiate the text. Nobody wants to be the stumbling block to this going forward. But at the same time, if every individual party to the convention is allowed to change or add things to the targets, then they will no longer be SMART. SMART is specific, measurable, achievable, realistic, and time-bound. And this is the main thing that was highlighted when they first got together. They said, we want SMART targets. We want ambitious targets. But they're going to continue losing this if the discussions become more and more complicated about individual inputs rather than, you know, combined efforts towards what they want to achieve. The GBF cannot afford to fail, because this time there's a lot more witnesses watching, because society is aware.